Well, hello and good afternoon and welcome to this MCTV sports production of High School Football. It's the 54th annual Battle of the Strip between the Capuchino Mustangs and the Mills Vikings. Hello everyone, I'm Kenny Milch alongside my broadcast partner Steve Henderson. And Steve, it's a new era for the Mills Vikings under their new head coach, and they've already made some positive strides.
That's right, Kenny. Their head coach, Mike Krieger, has got things going in the right direction. This year, the team has 3 wins, whereas in the previous year, they only had 1. In addition, he's led the team to their first league victory in 3 seasons.
And that victory was in their Lake Division opener over Coralmont. Meanwhile, Capuchino has steamrolled over the Lake Division, going 4-0. Last year, they shared a tri-championship, and with a victory today over Mills, they can win it outright.
Head coach Adam Hyman of Capuchino has been doing it with the run. He's been using superstar tailback Justin Ewing, who has rushed for over 2,500 yards this season. He needs 297 yards today to become the single-season CCS rushing champion and set that record. He is special.
That he is, and the mark that he is chasing was set back in 1997 by Burlingame's Onan Reyes. This should be a good one. We'll have some more news and notes, plus the kickoff coming up next. Has a new coach and new system in place this year. Their successes over the season have been in part to a fresh attitude and a healthy dose of senior leadership. In order to challenge the Mustangs, Mills will have to step up their game and play smart football. In this segment, we'll meet some of those seniors and hear from them and Coach Mike Krieger about what they need to do to be capped in this Battle of the Strip.
My name is Herschel Law. I'm the quarterback for the Mills Varsity football team. Well, as a team offensively, we have to come out and execute our plays, make sure every drive we get downfield and put some points on the board. Individually, I just have to go out there and perform and do my job, not turn the ball over, make the safe plays, and take what the defense gives us. I try and lead my team, and hopefully lead my team to victory on Saturday, you know. But as the quarterback, I try not to do too much. I just do what's necessary to help win the game.
I'm Joey Hamiro. I play fullback and middle linebacker. To win the game, basically, just do exactly what our coaches have been telling us. Finish after every play, finish during practice, finish our sprints, finish everything that we have, and just do all around, just have a good game. We built a brotherhood, and everybody feels great about how we're playing. You know, we could always get better when we play, and that's what we plan on doing this week, is just playing our hearts out, playing to the whistle, playing as much as we can, and just having fun.
Anthony Vozaitis, a linebacker and tight end. Our biggest strength probably is that we play as a team, or play as a family, and we just got each other's back, and no matter what happens, we're in it together.
Well, it's going to take a supreme effort. They're very physical on offense, they're very physical on defense. They run the ball in between the tackles. They've got a running back that's close to setting a CCS rushing record. So it's going to take our team to execute the defensive game plan, rally to the football, and make sure Ewing ends up on the ground. Coaching football is the next best thing to playing high school football. And I think it's important if you are passionate about the sport to impart that knowledge down to the next generation coming up. For me, it's thoroughly enjoyable to coach, try to mentor young men, try to give them what I received and maybe what I didn't receive as a high school athlete, and watch them grow.
We know that both teams in today's game, in addition to having some great athletes, also have some great personalities. In a new MCTV sports feature, we get a chance to meet some of the senior Mustangs in a segment produced by Mr. Begue's Art of Video class at Capuchino High.
So my name is Sirius Collins. I'm a 4-year senior varsity player. I am a left tackle on offense and a defensive nose guard and tackle on defense. So what makes this team unique this year is that kind of like a renaissance phase for Capuchino football. as this is the first time we won the championship, like flat out, just all by ourselves, for like the first time in like 40-something years, and I think it's pretty special. And the fact that we also have four championships as a class. Our coaching staff is amazing. Coach Hyman, as head coach, really tries to bring the best out of all of his players. He'll really make sure that you perform at your highest potential. I'd like to give a special shout out to the six captains of the Capuchino Varsity football team. They really make sure things are held together. We have a fun time. We always do our best and are leaders in their own special way.
Hi, my name is Justin Ewing. I'm a senior at Capuchino High School. I'm the running back for the Mustangs football team. Last year, we had set the foundation for excelling and building winning teams on Varsity, and I feel that this year we have really built upon that and met and exceeded our expectations. I feel like I've accomplished most of my goals that I have set for this season. I really have built a strong connection with almost everybody on my team, and I feel that we have come together as a team. And I feel that I have worked well and hard every single game, and I put forth the work in the off season to make a season like this happen.
My name is Zachary Coates. I play tight end defensive end, and I'm a senior at Capuchino High School. So this year, we have confidence, and something Capuchino football hasn't had for decades. Because we know last year we went out, we won a championship, we knew this year we can go the same thing and even one up that. The coaches we have right now know how to motivate us. They know how to, if we need it, get under our skin, push us harder, make us win football games. What I miss about football, I'm going to miss winning. I mean, this, after tomorrow, is going to be my fourth football championship in four seasons of playing football. So I'm going to really miss that winning attitude, that winning record, and just playing the game.
Bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare.
Checking the standings of the PAL Lake Division from 2012, and it is Capuchino once again on top at 4-0, and overall 5-4. Second place San Mateo 4-1, El Camino 3-2, followed by Hillsdale and Mills at 1-3. They are 3-5-1 overall. As far as the points scoring comparison goes, Capuchino has scored 245 on the season, and they have allowed 263. Mills has scored 167 and allowed 217. So while Capuchino's defense has allowed a lot of points, Steve, they've been able to come up with four league victories.
Absolutely, and they do that with their bludgeoning running back, Justin Ewing. He's a punishing runner who pretty much controls the tempo of the game with his slashing and powerful running style. Ewing this season is averaging 7.8 yards per carry, believe it or not, and as a result, Capuchino can control the game, control the tempo, and control the clock. That's why they're in control this season, Ken.
Once again, it's the 54th straight meeting in this rivalry. Capuchino has won 33 of the games. Mills has won 20, and Capuchino has won the last two in 2011 and 2010. The last Mills victory came in 2009 when they won at Capuchino by the final score of 48-41. They are on the field getting set for the kickoff. Capuchino will kick and Mills will receive. Mills, of course, in their scarlet and gold uniforms, and Capuchino in their white jerseys with their khaki colored pants. And here is the kickoff. We are underway in the 54th annual Battle of the Strip, and the return is taken at the 5-yard line by the Mills special team return man, Josh Sved, and he has taken down near the 20-yard line, and it'll actually be spotted near the 17, and it'll be first and 10 for the Mills Vikings.
On that play, it looked like he was trying to head up the right hash and ran out of blockers and ran out of room, was taken down by two Mills special teams defenders on the play.
Okay. At quarterback for the Vikings, Herschel Lull. He is a senior, has a player in motion. Here's a handoff over the left side to Antonio Jeffrey, and he's brought down quickly at the line of scrimmage. Leading that tackle for Capuchino was Royal Ali.
You know, in a discussion that I had with head coach Mike Krieger before the game, he indicated that they run a balanced attack, that they're going to try to get the ball in the hands of Jeffries on many occasions, as we saw in that play. And they ran, as you can see in the replay, a counter-style run, and he sees and runs downhill. Very effective pickup, 3 yards on the first play.
Second and 8. Quick hitch out to the right side. That pass is caught by Svet up near the first down marker. It tripped up over there by the Capuchino defender, Anthony Pellegrini, but there is a penalty down on the field.
Looks like the preliminary call appears to be holding, and on that play, they ran what you call a bubble screen, and they swung it out. Sorry, go ahead, Ken. We'll pick it up. Oh, we're going to pick up the referee in the call just now.
John Petrovich.
Replay second down.
Sorry about that, Steve. Go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. We're moving along here. They swung that out there on that bubble screen, and the wide receiver's supposed to hold, or not hold, excuse me. You got caught holding, but block on the edge, and while blocking, got caught for the 10-yard penalty.
Unfortunate, because Mills was very close to a first down. Instead, they're looking at about second and 16, backed up in their own end. Here's a pitch out to Jeffrey over the left side. He's trying to get to the edge, but he is unable to do so as he is driven out of bounds by Devon Lorenzini, and that's going to go for a very minimal gain, and Capuchino really strung that out well.
They did, and they Mills lined up in a wing-style deal where they moved the blocker over to that strong side with the tight end, and essentially just said, we're coming that way, see if you can stop us, and that time Capuchino did.
Ball is spotted near the 15-yard line. We're looking at third and about 16 from the shotgun. Looking downfield, the pass is thrown and incomplete. Intended there for Anthony Vozaides, and Lall's pass was slightly off, so Mills on their first possession is going to be forced to punt.
On that play, they lined up with four wide receivers, or four receivers, we call it ace formation, and a single back. They snapped it shotgun and tried to get something happening up the middle of the field to try to pick up that first down, and the pass just kind of fell incomplete.
Victor Beglitzoff with the punt back to receive for Capuchino, Anthony Pellegrini, and it's a high punt that gets caught up in the wind and takes a Capuchino bounce, is finally down there by the Mills special teamer Justin Huang, and it's going to be absolutely tremendous field position for Coach Heineman as he sends his offense for the Mustangs onto the field.
You bring an interesting point up about the wind, Kenny. When that punt went up, it went straight up in the air and seemed to get caught up. And Capuchino indeed planted on a short field for their first play. And my guess, it's going to be going to Ewing.
Pia Dawe, the quarterback. Here's a handoff to the tailback, Ewing, and he's able to gain forward close to a couple, maybe three. That's going to bring up a second and 7. And once again, this day, although it's dedicated to the team and Capuchino looking for the outright PAL Lake Division Championship, it's also a special day in honoring Justin Ewing.
Absolutely, and he is the centerpiece of this team. It's heart and soul. You can expect him to pound the rock, we say, at least 35 times during tonight, today's contest.
On second and eight, Ewing the tailback. They give it to him. Two plays, two handoffs. He's hit at the line by a host of Mills tacklers, but he's able to gain forward maybe for about four more, maybe five. It's going to bring up a third and about three. So two carries for Ewing. And we're going to give him a total of 6 yards. It's going to be third and four. Now he needs 293, Steve.
Well, you know, he's just going to keep pounding away. And we know that's the type of runner he is. He's a relentless downhill runner. And those tackles that these kids have to keep making on him take their toll on those linebackers.
And Dowey's going to throw. He throws a quick swing pass. They get it to Ewing. It won't be counted as a rush, but he's up near the first down marker and may have it as he's spun back to the inside. And assisting on that tackle was Andrew Singh, the senior linebacker for the Vikings, and it is indeed a first down for Capuchino.
And you can see on the replay that he gets out into the flat and gets his body turned around nice. He gets vision on that ball, makes a nice move, and gets upfield for the first down. So he's got more than just the running back skills, but he's also got a nice pair of hands on him on that play.
First and 10, Mustangs at the 14. Handoff to Ewing over right tackle. He's hit at the line and dropped for a very minimal gain. In on that stop for the Vikings was Jephtha Zapata. And it's going to go for two. It's going to bring up a second and eight.
Interesting on that play, the footing out there on the field a little bit soft, because when Ewing took his first step, his cleat actually slipped out from under him. He had to regather his balance, and by the time he hit the hole, it had closed. So we have a situation here where they could go to their tight end, which might not be a bad idea.
From the 12-yard line, they give it to Ewing again, who breaks a tackle at the line and lunges forward. He's inside the 10-yard line, and he's going to be close to another first down for Capuchino. And they're signaling it's going to be third. It's going to be a tough angle all day for us here trying to judge where they are, especially on the far side. We're down pretty low. We'd ideally like to be up high, but these Mills stands don't go very up. Go very high.
No, they don't. And it looks like they can pick up a first down with about a 2 yard gain on third down here. Let's see what they do.
From the four, give to Ewing off right tackle again. They like going at spot, and he is hit at the line. He tries to lunge forward and he spins and he's in. Touchdown Capuchino on a 4 yard run by Justin Ewing.
Well, that drive recap, and we can just say Ewing. They had one pass completed to him, but the rest were runs to him, and he successfully caps that off, as we see here on the replay, by just continuing to churn those feet until he gets to pay dirt. Trouble on the extra point.
And there's going to be a tackle in the backfield. In on that for Mills was Austin Miyamoto and also Anthony Voisides. And that's going to be 6-0. The Mustangs on top as they break the scoring column first.
On that PAT, the snap came back on the ground. It was just kind of dribbling along. And unfortunately for the holder, he couldn't pick that up in time to do anything with it. By the time he had his hands on it, he was in trouble.
There you saw a shot of Mike Krieger in his first year as head coach of the Mills Vikings. 1-3 in the Lake Division, 3-5-1 overall. He replaced Packy Moss, who coached Mills for 5 years, and Moss went 9-40-1 overall in PAL divisional play. Moss went 7-19-1. And actually, Krieger was the head coach of the Frost Soft team at Half Moon Bay the previous 2 years before coming over to Mills. More on Coach Krieger in a bit, but here the Mustangs are going to kick off leading 6-0 here in the first quarter on Jim Cox Field. And a return is taken at the 15-yard line, and breaking through and having daylight is Svet. Svet is now at the 50, gets into Capuchino territory with a wonderful run back of 47 yards.
Outstanding vision, as we see here on the special teams play. He uses his vision to cut back and find lanes, picks up some key blocks early in that run, and the rest is all him. He really creased Capuchino there and gave his team an excellent opportunity starting this drive in Capuchino territory. Special teams, a big part of the game.
There's an injured player on the field. It appears to be a Viking, although I can't quite see through the players that are on, and he actually, it might be a Mustang player. Maybe we can get a shot on one of the monitors here.
Well, special teams plays do involve a lot of change of direction and a lot of speed, and so sometimes you get an ankle or something happening. Hopefully that guy's okay.
Once again, Mike Krieger, the Vikings' first-year head coach, has been coaching football since 1990. He's been at Half Moon Bay, Lowell High School, Lincoln, and Mills. He's had three different stints at Half Moon Bay, and this is the second stint with Mills, as the Capuchino player is able to limp off under his own power. That is Jamie Vaquez, and good thing is he's going to be okay. Mills with that great field position for Coach Krieger here in his first Battle of the Strip contest. It's the 54th annual. Capuchino's won 33 and the Vikings have won 20.
Right, you know, and these teams, when you play your rival, no matter what the records, you always find that the teams play harder.
And it's rivalry weekend here on the peninsula for all the PAL teams. There's an inside handoff to the fullback as taken there. I believe that was Joey Himuro.
Vikings keep the ball on the ground and give it to
and
42.
Himuro is the senior running back, and he was one of the captains that went onto the field here on senior day as they had a nice parade honoring both the seniors from Capuchino and Mills, a tradition on this Battle of the Strip afternoon.
You couldn't have a better day. A little crisp, chilly air. Fall is finally coming to the Bay Area. A great day for football.
A lot of balloons out, festive atmosphere, and here's a pass by Law, complete in the flat, taken by Victor Beglitzoff. That's going to be good enough for a Mills Viking first down.
On that play, Kenny, we see that he ran what we call a hitch route, where essentially he takes advantage of the soft coverage by the Capuchino corners that Capuchino are playing at about 7 to 8 yards off, and so he runs a route and pulls it up short, underneath the coverage, makes the catch, picks up extra yardage, and a first down.
Lal's going to operate from the shotgun. He's got Himura to his right and trips out to the right as well. He looks out to the right and he throws out to the right. He has a man, but it's slightly overthrown. Pass intended for Sved, and it's incomplete. That'll bring up second and 10. They try to overload that right side that time.
They really did. That trips package, and they do what we like to call a flood route in kind of football vernacular, where they send everyone on that trip side over into that zone. It's a zone buster, and unfortunately the pass is a little bit off target and fell incomplete.
When Krieger was at Mills in 2003, that team was undefeated league champions, and he's had several players play in colleges. That give to Jeffrey is good for a gain out to the left sideline.
On that running play, they ran an option style look, and essentially they had a fake to the inside running back number 42, Joey Himuro, and then they tossed it to Antonio Jeffrey, who picked up about 4 on the play, trying to work those edges on Capuchino.
Single back is Himura, back to throw as Lawley fires one out to the left side, and it's a little bit high, but possibly catchable, intended for Beglitzoff. Incomplete. That's going to bring up a fourth down situation. I was trying to mention that he had several players back when Krieger was with the Vikings as an assistant coach in 2003. One of the most notable was Paul Fanica, who actually played in the NFL.
Well, you know, it's a special thing when any player from the peninsula, any of these schools, makes it as far as the NFL, and it's tremendous tribute to the coaches when you know you had something to do with a player moving that far along.
They're going to go for it. Mills is on 4th and about 7. The pass is caught over the right side, over near the sideline. It's caught by Sved. A nice throw and a nice catch. Tackle made by Devon Lorenzini, and that was great timing there. Law really slung it out. He's got a nice arm.
He really does. And in checking again with Coach Mike Krieger before the game, he mentioned that Law is one of his special players and that he really gets it done on offense, the senior quarterback. Knows how to sling it around the yard on that play. It was such a well-timed route that the ball came out of his hand before the receiver even made his break, and that's why it was so hard to defend.
Mills moving the ball nicely now inside the 20 in the red zone of Capuchino. Here's a handoff to Jeffrey up the middle, and he bounced it outside. Well done inside the 10-yard line. That's a nice chunk of yardage for Coach Krieger and his offensive unit.
Absolutely. And, you know, now here's the situation. You come into a game like this, and everyone's talking about, you know, the Capuchino running back, Justin Ewing. Hey, Mills has got a running back of their own, Antonio Jeffrey, that can also pound the rock. And we see there on that play, he's got some pride, and he makes a nice gain of 8 on first down.
And he's over 1,000 yards this season. Here's an inside handoff to the fullback. I believe that was Himura, and he's hit at the line. He's able to get through and actually gain a couple, actually even maybe 4 or 5. That's going to be good enough for a first down. We're going to have a first and goal situation.
The best defense in this game for Mills is a great offense. And in the situation that they're in right now, they're controlling the tempo. They started this drive in Capuchino territory, and it looks like they might be ready to punch it in.
Jeffries to the left, Himura to the right. There goes Sved in motion. They give it to the fullback. Himura tries up the middle. He's up near the goal line. He's going to be stopped just shy. Give him a couple, maybe a yard. It's going to bring second and goal. And while the Mustang defense was keying on Jeffrey, the Vikings tried to shove it in with the fullback, Himura.
He's had success running the ball. Each of these running backs for Mills today has had success in their own way moving the ball. And so I expect Mills to continue to force Capuchino to defend the entire goal line, the width of the goal line, on this particular play coming up.
Second and goal from the 5. And it's going to be a quick hitch out to the left side. Pass is caught by Sved. Spins up near the goal line. Going to be just shy. That'll bring up a third and goal situation. They do some really quick hitters to try to catch the corners off balance.
They're absolutely trying to get that ball out in the flat. It's a great play by design to kind of get the whole width of the goal line defended. And if someone slips up or misses a tackle, you're in the end zone. So my expectation is that they're going to hit the middle of the formation this time.
Here's a handoff to Jeffrey. He tries right tackle. He's hit by a couple cap defenders. He spins. He's still on his feet. He's going to make a great run towards the pylon. He dives for it, and he's in. Touchdown, Vikings. A spectacular run by Antonio Jeffrey.
That was incredible how he manages to stay on his feet after initial contact and willed himself with his body moving forward to get into that end zone, the final effort diving towards the pylon to get 6 and find Peters.
On to kick the extra point with Victor Beglitzov. And the snap from the Vikings is low, handled by the holder and almost blocked, but it's through. Nicely done by the holder, which is Sved. The good hands team handles the short hop, and that point could end up being critical, especially since Cap missed their extra point try.
Absolutely. All phases of the game critical, and so that special teams play there, handling the snap and making sure that they could get that kickoff, very, very important. You've got to imagine that head coach Mike Krieger is extremely proud of his team, the way they managed to march the ball down in their first possession, 55 yards, mixing it up with the run and pass. Here's the outstanding run by Jeffries and the score. Earlier in that shot, you see where he was hit and kept his balance, spun, and found pay dirt. He's got pride, this Mills team's got pride, and this game, again being a rivalry game, you're going to see an entertaining contest, as we already have so far.
Well, you got Aragon, Hillsdale, Terranova, Half Moon Bay, South City, and El Camino. And here we've got the Battle of the Strip. There's also Burlingame, San Mateo. It's rivalry weekend, and we got a good one here from Jim Cox Field in Millbrae on the campus of Mills High School. On the return for the Mustangs was Anthony Pellegrini, and he is tackled up near the 30-yard line, and that's where the Capuchino Mustangs will have it first and 10, down 7-6 here in the first quarter.
He's upended. A nice low tackle on that play by the special teams defender from Mills. These Mills Vikings are hitting hard, and they're playing and they're defending their home turf today. Let's see what they do on defense now in the second possession for Capuchino.
Late substitution, just barely getting off the field. It was the Vikings players, a pitch out to Ewing, and he's hit in the backfield. Great penetration there, and a nice tackle by Gabe Sanchez, the defensive lineman, only a junior. He looked like a veteran senior on that play.
He really, you know, the thing about defense that's essential, and you'll see it here, is that you play gap sound, and so these guys are able to have him leveraged on the inside. Basically, he can't cut back, and they have him covered on the outside. Nowhere to go, and they gang tackle to finish it off, Kenny. They must have had a great week of defensive practice, judging from that play anyway.
And it goes over a loss of four. Second and 14, pitch out to Ewing. He breaks through the line, and he is caught with an ankle tackle and grabbing hold for the Vikings, and knocking Ewing down was Anthony Voizides. That's going to go for a gain of maybe five, now six. It's going to bring up a third and eight.
The thing about, and you see it here, you see the desire on both sides there, defensively and offensively on the replay with the run by Ewing. The defense has to continue tackling, as Ewing will continue to run.
I formation, they give it to Ewing. He tries right tackle. He's hit hard at the line. An initial tackle was making by Justin Sow. And once again, Gabe Sanchez was in there. And it's going to be relied upon heavily for that defensive line, not only to get penetration, to make the hit and then hold on, because Ewing is so strong and powerful that one hit ain't going to take him down.
Right. Relentless is the word that comes to mind when I think about his running style. You look at the impact of that tackle there in the replay. I don't know who got the worst of that. Okay, so they did stop Capuchino at the same time. These players on both sides of the ball are going to be in for some tremendous shots today.
Fourth and four. Sved is back to receive the punt. There's contact on the punter, and a flag comes out. And it's going to be a penalty on roughing the punter, and it wasn't really that rough. The kicker was injured earlier in the game, Jamie Vaquiz, but he has recovered, and the referee, John Petrovic, wants to protect him, and it's going to be, or running into the kicker, if you will. Here's the call. Okay. May have forgot to flip on his mic that time. It's going to be running into the kicker. So that's a crucial penalty. Mills would have taken over possession of the ball with the lead. And we talked about it earlier. You want to keep Ewing and that Mustang offense off the field as much as possible.
Football is a game of momentum, Kenny, and the situation there, they had made the stop. They're going to get off the field, get their offense back on and control the tempo. And a mistake, although it's an effort mistake, cost them that time. Now they're going to have to stop them again.
21 players on the field, total for Mills. And there's a flag on the play. Pass by Dowie, going deep, has a man. And it's slightly underthrown and incomplete. There is, once again, a penalty on the incomplete pass from Dowie. So they go Ewing about 27,000 times, and then they look on the deep ball down the sideline.
Right. Hey, that was a well-thrown ball. And essentially, it turns out that he didn't really just adjust to that ball in the air. It was not then able to really come back to it as effectively. Otherwise, he would have made a great catch. Apparently, that call was a sideline warning on the Mills bench area. So, no penalty, second and 10.
I formation for the Mustangs, Ewing, the tailback. He gets the carry over the tight end spot, and he's grabbed low and knocked down once again. A nice tackle there by the Viking defender, Jephthah Zapata. We've already called his name a few times. And it's really Mills, just a matter of concentrating on Ewing and kind of gang tackling. And when you get a solo opportunity, you've got to take him down.
Absolutely, and well, he makes up about 90% of their offense. If you look at the statistics over the year for Capuchino, they're averaging about 290 yards of offense a game, and he is accounting for the vast majority of that statistically.
Here's an inside handoff. And that time it was taken by one of the other.
Number 42 for the Vikings on the stop.
I think that was Hugo Gutierrez,
right,
number 35.
They looked like they did a little bit of a fullback trap, tried to catch Mills off guard, having them key pretty much on Ewing all day. They thought they might be able to pop that little inside run to the fullback and pick up the first down. Mills was alert to it, made the stop.
So it's fourth down, about four. On comes the punting unit, and Vaquiz kicks it and bounces near the 25. Sved's going to let it roll, and that's where it'll be downed. Mills will take over, so they get the stop anyways, but they had to have their defense on the field. And we talked about just having 21 players, 11 are on the field, only 10 substitutions, and that has been a problem for the Mills squad in general, roster size, and it usually comes into play in the third and fourth quarter when fatigue and conditioning come into play.
Well, that's the thing, and so you see here early in the game where the Capuchino Mustangs keep running and pounding Ewing, they've got an advantage in terms of numbers. They can substitute more guys, and typically, as you just mentioned, Kenny, over the course of a game, a team with guys that are pretty much all playing in all phases will wear it down. I think that's what Capuchino was counting on happening here today.
An audible called at the line by Herschel Lall and a misdirection, and there is a broken play, so Lall ends up keeping it, and he tries to go over to the left tackle area and try to get something out of nothing. There was a little confusion in the backfield. Lall tried to call the audible, and I don't think all the backs got the memo on that one.
No, they were apparently misaligned from the very beginning, and he was trying to get them to figure out what they were doing, and they're just lucky that they held onto the ball because they're deep in their territory. The last thing you want to do is turn it over down there and give Capuchino a super short field.
So ball is at the 15-yard line, second and 10 for the Vikings. From the shotgun now is Lall, the senior. He hands off to Jeffrey from the wing slot, and on the reverse, he's able to get forward, maybe for a couple. He's brought down by the big Capuchino captain, Sirius Collins, and Sirius actually helped us a little bit last year with the color commentary at Capuchino when you were unfortunately unable to make it to that game.
Well, you know, it sounds like he's a fine young man, that he had an opportunity to kind of see what if he might enjoy the broadcast experience. This first quarter has been super fast today. It really moved fast because both these teams are running the ball pretty much.
At the end of one, 7-6 Mills leads. We'd like to thank the Millbrae Chamber of Commerce for sponsoring this event. The Chamber of Commerce is a nonprofit association that promotes and supports outstanding businesses in Millbrae. Local organizations and residents can join, and members receive discounts to local businesses. If you'd like to join, contact millbrae.com or call 697-7324 for more information. Thanks again to the Millbrae Chamber of Commerce.
So, Kenny, the story of that first half is that but for that missed extra point opportunity by Capuchino, we have a tie ball game. Both teams are putting forth an equal effort, and we'll have to see what happens as they take the field in this second quarter.
A quick update on Capuchino Mustang running back Justin Ewing. He is going for the CCS single season rushing mark. Thus far, he's got 9 carries for 29 yards. He needs 267 to break the mark. And on third and about 7, a quick hitch from Lall over the middle. That pass is caught by Jeffries. Jeffries up to the 50, now to the 40. And Jeffries is brought down from behind on a touchdown saving tackle by Anthony Pellegrini. And what an explosive play. A quick seam route up the middle, maybe even a little post, and a well-timed play. And Jeffries took off with it.
It almost seems, as you see on the replay here, that they caught Capuchino secondary kind of napping on that. They creased him, and Cap's playing zone. They have, you know, a single safety high, and there was really no one home. He ran right by his defender, caught the ball, and he was home free, but for the touchdown saving tackle.
High formation, they give it to Jeffries over the right tackle. He breaks through the line. He's got some daylight. He cuts back up to the middle, and he's inside the 20-yard line. And all of a sudden, Jeffrey is starting to feel it today, Steve.
Well, he's making sure everybody knows that Justin Ewing's not the only running back in town. He's making the plays that count today. And on that play, he cut back on the counter play, and he picked up a fantastic block by his outside receiver Victor Beglisoff, and found additional room because the receiver was doing a good job blocking downfield. A fine run by number one. For Mills.
First and 10 from the 14 for the Vikings. Penalty flag comes out.
Offense. Go first down.
And it goes against the Vikings, as you heard referee John Petrovich. The umpire today is Mike Echeverry. The head linesman is Keith Griggs. Line judge Russell Kyle. And the back judge is J.C. Avakian. I'm Kenny Milch alongside Steve Henderson on this MCTV Sports production, the 54th annual Battle of the Strip. coming to you from Mills High School on Jim Cox Field, home of the Vikings. And Mills is on top 7-6, and they are threatening. First and 15 from the 19. Fast over the middle, pass is caught. Touchdown Vikings. Victor Beklitzoff, 19 yards. And Mills is for real today, Steve.
They found something out about Capuchino. And it appears as though the Capuchino defensive secondary can be exploited. Perhaps Coach Mike Krieger has taken a look at some tape and may understand that there's some openings in the zone. That time it was just a simple slant route. And as a result of no one getting in the zone area between receiver and quarterback, they're able to complete the pass and sail into the end zone for the touchdown.
Victor Beklitzoff with the extra point, and it is no good. So they had a tough snap. That time the snap was good, the hold was good, the kick was off this time.
Well, and so now Mills returns the favor, essentially. Yeah, as you can see, wonderful, excellent play there on the replay on the slant ball for the touchdown. And you know, it comes down to execution in all phases of the game. That apparently was scouted. Mills saw something they liked. They like a matchup with a corner playing soft and no one really on the inside. Slant post all day. They're thinking of success throwing the ball.
And we mentioned that Ewing had 29 yards on 9 carries. Jeffrey has 28 yards on 8 carries, but he also has 44 yards on that one reception. Herschel Lall is 4 of 8 on the day for 63 yards, including that last touchdown pass to Beklitzoff. So the Vikings on top 13-6 here, trying to upset Capuchino and prevent them from going undefeated in the PAL Lake Division. Here's a little pooch kickoff to one of the up backs, and it bounces at the 20. That's a live ball, don't forget. And it's finally fell on by Chris Costa. And that's going to be actually a nice strategy for Coach Krieger. And sometimes it can come back to bite you, but that time it worked in Mills' favor.
Right. You know, and being a coach for quite a while myself at the high school level and actually working the special teams over at Aragon High School, we like to kick the ball to a particular side of the field. You know, why defend the whole field when you're on your kickoff coverage? And so we try not to do that. And it appears as though that was a strategy used there by Mills' coach, Mike Krieger.
So Justin Ewing and the Mustang offense back on the field. Quarterback Paya Dawe is going to throw on first and 10. He pump fakes and now he scrambles. He's going to tuck it and run, and he's hit hard. He stays on his feet and he's able to lunge forward for a nice gain. That was well done. And Paya Dawe says Justin Ewing can break tackles. Well, hey, I can too.
Right. You know, sometimes you just have to make a play, Kenny. In that situation, they thought they might be able to find somebody downfield. They couldn't. But then again, because some of the Mills players were off in coverage, dropped off, there's a lot of room there, and he's able to pick up the first down. Well done.
Gain of 12 on that play. So first and 10, and the ball is spotted at the 27 of Capuchino. And there's Dawe under center, hand off to Ewing over the right side. He's hit by 1, 2, 3, 4 Viking defenders. And once again, in on that stop, Justin Sow along with Jepta Zapata and two other Viking friends. Gain of 4, maybe even 5. That'll bring up 2nd and 5.
Just looking at the pounding run, he's a bludgeon. He is giving those linebackers everything and more on every snap. And at some point, the question is, are those inside linebackers for Mills going to get tired of tackling him, and is he going to break a big one?
And Ewing is used to carrying a heavy load. We'll go over some of his season statistics in just a minute. Speaking of the devil, there's Ewing over the right side. He's dragging a few defenders with him, and he won't go down until he gets a first down. It's going to go for about a gain of 9. And it's going to be a first down. Capuchino and Ewing this season. Game 1 against Valley Christian, 24 carries, 169 yards. Game 2 against South City, 32 carries, 212 yards. And then in game 3, you may have to sit down for this one, Steve. 44 carries, 494 yards against Gunn, which was a CCS single game record.
I just, I have to sit down. It's a good thing I'm already sitting down. And I find that completely shocking to note that he was that effective.
Quick pass by Dowey, and it's caught by Devon Lorenzini. That's going to be close to another Capuchino first down. And now the Mustangs have a nice little drive going.
Well, you know, and what they're doing is wonderful in a sense, Capuchino, that is they're forcing Mills to defend the whole field, okay? So they, you know, you've got your bludgeon, you've got your hammer there, you know, with Ewing, and then on the edges you have, you know, Lorenzini and a couple of the other receivers that can make plays for you as well.
Single back, it's Ewing. He tries over left guard this time. He's hit very quickly in the backfield. Making first contact for the Vikings was Jerry Dudum. It's going to go for a gain of three. That's going to bring up second and seven. And we go back to week number four for Justin Ewing against Burlingame. 36 carries for 286 yards. Versus Aragon, 36 carries, 156 yards. El Camino, 39 carries, 240 yards, and there's still more. Here on second and eight, Dowey is going to throw. He steps up in the pocket, and he throws, and it's slightly overthrown out to the right side, falls to an incomplete. It's going to bring up third and eight. Let's go to game number seven against Hillsdale, which is a victory for Capuchino. Ewing had 38 carries for 363 yards. Week number eight against San Mateo, 42 carries, 303 yards. And last week against Carlmont, 30 carries for 297 yards. You add that all up, Steve. 321 carries this season, 2,520 yards for Justin Ewing. Oh, and by the way, 26 touchdowns.
Oh, you know, just sprinkled 26 in there for the heck of it. Yeah, he's a special player. When we faced Capuchino, that is Aragon, where I coach, we faced Capuchino and were elated to hold him down to 156 yards on 36 carries. In that game, he did bust a 45-yard touchdown over right tackle on us, gashed us for a big gain and a touchdown, and we were happy to come away from the game without him doing more damage. He's an outstanding player, and you know, as it is with some of these players that are outstanding, from when I've been in discussions with Coach Adam Heineman and other people on the Capuchino campus, turns out that Ewing may be a better person than he is a ball player, and that's what you usually find with great athletes like him, is that they are quality people as well.
And he has a hearing impediment he was born with, and last year there was another player, Jordan Griffiths, who also had a hearing impediment, and he is able to overcome that. And it is just really shows what an outstanding young man that he is and what kind of spirit he has. Here on third and seven, third and eight, a pass is caught. Nicely thrown ball by Piadaway, excuse me. Good for another first down, and that was a well-thrown ball. Both quarterbacks have nice arms today.
Looked like that might have been tight end Zach Kotz, I'm pretty sure, on the play. On that catch, looked like a little seam ball there, and a nice throw and catch on the play for the first down.
Ball spotted at the 25-yard line, first and 10 Mustangs. High formation, Ewing the tailback. They give it to Justin over the left side. He's hit there low and quickly by Vozides. He's able to gain maybe 3 yards. It's going to bring up a second and seven, and let's do another quick update. Remember, the magic number for Ewing today to break the all-time single-season rushing record, 279, and he's now at 245. So in 13 carries, check that, 12 carries, 46 yards. Make that 13 carries, and he's at 51 yards on the night, or the day.
Accumulating rapidly is Ewing this morning and afternoon.
Second and eight, they give it to Ewing over the left tackle spot. He's hit once again near the line. He's able to lunge forward maybe for a couple. Ewing making the tackle for Mills was Josh Sved, and they're actually going to give him close to five on the play. And third and four.
He has a relentless running style, and he is essentially making these Mills defenders pay for every tackle, which, and he is too, but he's that kind of runner where he dishes out more punishment than he takes, and you can see it by the way he runs the rock.
And he shot a nice close-up shot of Mike Krieger, the Mills Vikings head coach, trying to figure out how to stop this Mustang attack. Here's a handoff to Ewing over the right guard. He breaks it up the middle, and he could be gone. Up near the goal line, stays on his feet, and stumbles into the end zone. Touchdown, Mustangs, and that's a great portrayal of what Ewing can do. You can hit him low, you can hit him hard, but then once he gets through, he's able to break free and head to the happy zone where he's been now 27 times.
Absolutely, Kenny. Well said. And the thing is that he was able to stay really tight as we see him tumbling in the end zone in a replay, stayed in tight behind his blocker and avoided the first wave of defenders. And as a result, he broke into the second level and found his way to the end zone.
Arturo Picazzo with the extra point, good this time. So for Mills, they made their first extra point, missed their second. Capuchino missed their first and made their second. Two touchdowns each, two extra points each, and we're tied at 13 in the second quarter with 6:28 left to go.
We've got a good one on our hands here. And in this game right now, that the Mills defense has been holding Justin Ewing down a little bit in terms of his average yards per carry. Ewing has been averaging an astonishing 7.8 yards per carry. And essentially, this game, he has not had that type of success because of the gang tackling of Mills. I wouldn't be surprised, Kenny, to see, I hope, or at least if you're a Capuchino fan, that you'll see some kind of reverse or something off of the play to Ewing, because so many people are keying on him. That seems to me like it would be wide open. So expect to see something creative like that maybe later in the game from the Capuchino offensive mindset.
Sved and Jeffrey back to receive the kickoff. It's a squib kick taken by one of the up backs, and it's taken by the Mills special teamer, Justin Huang, and Huang is able to get forward up near the 35-yard line, and Mills will have decent field goal field position here in the second quarter. 6:18 remaining on the scoreboard until intermission here on Jim Cox Field.
Yeah, that special teams play was exciting. He kind of jitterbugged and seemed like he was going to find a little crease on the outside and then tried to tuck it back up in and got caught up with a wave of Capuchino defenders. Right as I was trying to say earlier, you know, Ewing generally averages almost 8 yards per carry. They're holding him down today to about 4 or 5, which is still outstanding.
Quick hitch from Lal out to Sved. Little contact just as Sved was trying to make the reception, and it was well defended there by Devon Lorenzini, and it's going to go for an incompletion, 2nd and 10.
That ball was in the air for an awfully long time, and if I'm the DB coach for Capuchino, I'm saying when that ball's in the air for that long, you drive on that ball and go get it, make a play on the ball. Good defense, and if you're not playing risky there, number 21 in the corner. So, again, the incompletion.
Yamura, the fullback, they fake it to him, and they try a quick pass over the middle, and it's incomplete, intended for Jeffrey, and it seems like Coach Krieger and his Viking offense, like you said earlier, they found a little spot, a little soft spot in the middle of that Cap defense, and they're trying to attack it.
Absolutely, and that's in that kind of what you would call hook curl zone. Essentially, your inside linebackers in a pass situation have to get back into that zone area, and if they're not, it's wide open, and we found that to be the case in the last couple of throws. Jeffrey's unable to hold on to that last throw.
Score tied at 13, 3rd and 10. Lal is looking to throw. Lal is scrambling. Now it's Jeffrey. Jeffrey over the left side tries to get to the edge. It was going to be some type of an option pass as Jeffrey ended up with the ball, and he appeared to be looking to throw it. Normally a running back. Let's take a look at the replay, Steve.
Right? Oh, yes, he sure was. He was heading a little bit off tackle. He was going to try to set up and throw, and it just didn't work out. Cap had it well defended. Maybe they'd seen something on film, but rather than rush up to tackle Jeffrey on the handoff, they stayed in their defensive responsibilities, didn't give him anywhere to throw the ball, and tackled him almost for a loss there.
Very interesting call here on 4th and 10, backed up in their own zone, and Mike Krieger is going to go for it. Very risky call here. Let's see how it turns out for the Vikings. I think they're just trying to draw Capuchino offside, so I think we were both a little bit scared. I think everybody in the Mills Vikings stands took a collective breath and now are a little bit relieved. We'll probably see the Vikings punt here.
Right, you know, and that's, you know, hey, you know, if you can make it 4th and 5, maybe you start thinking about a possibility of going for it. But, boy, I thought, man, 4th and 10, and I'm shrugging my shoulders, kind of wondering what the strategy was going to be, and clearly they were attempting to draw Cap offsides on that play.
You know, we asked Coach Krieger before the game how he felt about coaching, and he said, quote, coaching high school football is the next best thing to playing. I coach because it is important to impart what I know about the game to those interested in playing the game, end quote, from Coach Krieger, enjoying this Battle of the Strip contest, his first as the head coach. And they decide indeed to punt, and Bedlitzoff's kick is headed out to the right sideline. It's a good one, and it angles out of bounds near the 25-yard line, and actually they're going to spot it. Well, they haven't. They're going to chase the ball down first before they spot it, and it looks like maybe the 23. Nonetheless, it was a nice angled punt by Bedlitzoff.
It's going to be a field position type of situation with 5:49 on the clock. Capuchino, you know, stick with the strategy that you've had success with all season long. Maybe Ewing can break one on a run. They seem to be throwing the ball pretty well. Both these offenses are moving the ball pretty well. And so these fans have been treated to a pretty entertaining game so far. Both these teams playing it even to this point.
Ewing's magic number now down to 224 yards needed. He 15 carries, 72 yards and a touchdown. Here's a run over the right side. Now cutting back up the middle is Ewing. Finally dragged down, but not before he's getting close to first down yardage. Maybe a yard or two short. Gain of about 7. That'll bring up a second. No, maybe 8. Let's call it 2nd and 2.
He ran a counter behind big old number 77, Sirius Collins. You see on the replay, and he hugged him, stayed behind his blocking, cut off, and finished off that run for a gain of 8.
I formation for the Mustangs, and Ewing in his familiar spot. It's going to be another give to Justin, who plunges forward, good enough for a first down. Tackle made by Kimura, and the Mustangs move the chains once again.
Right, there another hard run, and he'll take you for 8, he'll take you for 3, he'll take you for 6, and he'll bust one for 40. His style, again, relentless. At the same time, you have to give a lot of credit to the Mills Viking defense, who is meeting his level of intensity and making some fine plays in the run game.
Ball spotted now at the 38 of Capuchino. What do you think? It's Ewing again on the counter play, and he is gang tackled by a ton of scarlet and gold players and brought down, and he's still going to gain about 4. They take on as many as they can throw at him.
That's what's happening. And they're going kitchen sink on this guy. They're throwing everything they've got, and he continues to carry the load. That's why I'm surprised we haven't seen some kind of reverse or something off of Ewing's action, because they're flying to him so much, keying to him so much, that would be wide open.
2nd and 6. Ewing over the right guard finds a hole. Nice block by the offensive lineman. And he's finally brought down. It's for Mills, Jamie Alfaro, and along Andre Singh. But another big chunk of yardage for Cap and Ewing. And, you know, Justin Ewing, when asked about breaking the record, he says, well, quote, it's nice to break records, but that is never really my focus, Ewing went on to say. I look at yards per carry. If I'm getting 5 yards a pop, I'm doing my job. 1st and 10, here's Ewing up the middle off left guard, and he's gang tackled once again. And we asked also Coach Hyman about his senior running back, and Coach Hyman said, quote, teams are playing 8 or 9 in the box against him. And he went on to say, quote, when it's 9 on 6, you have to break some tackles. Justin's primary strength is that he keeps his shoulders low and comes right at you, end quote.
Well, he's a downhill runner, a classic punishing style of runner. And he doesn't give you much to hit except for knees and shoulders, and he comes at you full speed.
Gain of 2 on that last one, 2nd and 8. Dowey is going to throw. He steps up in the pocket. He has a man. It's caught. Making the reception for the Capuchino Mustangs is that's that number 22. We had to track him down. He wasn't on our roster. Now I'm trying to read upside down. One of our runners went over and got it. Maybe one of our statisticians, Easy, can read that name for you. What do you got there?
It looks like there's an injury on the field on the tackle. Number 6 for Mills, that's Austin Miyamoto, who's down on the field right now after the tackle at the end of that most recent play. You were talking moments ago, Kenny, about Justin Ewing wanting to average about 5 yards a carry. I did some research and was looking at some NFL running backs, and it turns out that essentially an NFL or college running back who's working at the highest level is having 4.5 or so yards per rushing attempt. For example, Arian Foster of the Texans has 4 yards per carry this season. Adrian Peterson, 5.7 per carry. Ewing this season, 7.8 yards per carry.
He's getting it done, getting her done. We talked to him a little bit more as the Mills Vikings player is going to be walking off under his own power. And that player for the Vikes is Austin Miyamoto, so good to see him okay. And we asked Justin Ewing, he said, hard-nosed power football has been instilled in me. I love being a power back, end quote. That's there he gets the handoff. I'm sorry. No, it's a fake. It's a reverse and a wide open run. Heading for the happy zone is Pellegrini. He finds it. Touchdown, Mustangs. Nice design play there. 25 yards, and number Capuchino five, is back on top.
I love it, and that's the kind of thing that I was wondering when they were going to pull that rabbit out of the hat. You know, they had been setting it up all day, and I'd mentioned it once or twice that I thought they would have success because of the way Mills is keying so much on Ewing if they tried to pop some kind of reverse. And there they finally did it, and they did it to a high level of effectiveness to take the lead.
The extra point is good. Two in a row now for Arturo Picazzo. And you check the scoreboard, is 20-13. It is the Mustangs on top of the Vikings.
When Capuchino took that ball to begin that drive, there was about 5 minutes and 39 seconds on the clock. They scored quickly.
Stay tuned for upcoming sports events right after the new year. On January 15th, we'll be out on the soccer pitch bringing you boys soccer, Half Moon Bay at Mills. Then on January 22nd, we'll have girls soccer action with the same schools, Mills and Half Moon Bay again. Should be good games. We are still finalizing our schedule, but you can expect more local sports from MCTV with plans to cover wrestling, basketball, softball, and baseball. We may even get out to cover another track meet. Though this time we might bring some sunblock. It was pretty hot out there. You can visit mctv.tv for upcoming schedule information. Once again, Steve, MCTV Sports expanding their coverage over the past couple years, and so many athletes from Millbrae at Mills High School are so excited to see themselves on TV.
Well, it's great to have a tradition of media coverage for what you do locally in your community.
And here's a blast kick up the middle, and it could be recovered by the Mustangs. And it went off the leg of the Mills special teamer, Andrew Singh, and it ricocheted right back to Capuchino. They indeed have it. It wasn't quite a traditional onside kick, but that was the outcome.
That, you know, and that was intentional. They hit a hard squib kick right at the Mills player. And you teach your special teams frontline guys to get out of the way of that quick hard squib. If it's coming hot, get out of the way. Don't try to touch it. But that ball was on top of him so quickly that he was unable to react, and now it's cat ball.
Adam Hyman, the head coach of Capuchino, with a nice design, good trick play, and they get their ball in the hands of Ewing once again, who starts off at midfield and is able to gain forward for about five. It's going to bring up maybe four, second and six. So head coach Hyman in his third year overall at Cap, his second stint as Mustang head coach. He replaced Jeff Call back in 2006, and he replaced Jordan Seiden last year and coached in 2011. From the tailback spot, it's Ewing over left tackle, and he lunges forward and brought down by a couple Anthony tackles for Mills. Jamie Alfaro was in on that. And continuing on, Coach Hyman, his career record coming in 15-14 overall, 11-5 in PAL divisional play, as we have a Mills player down on the field, Jamie Alfaro, and let's hope he's okay. Hyman's first year was 2006. He went 4-6 and 3-4 in the Ocean Division. 2011, last year, went 6-4 and 4-1 in the Lake. Again, he shared a tri-championship. And here this year, 4-0 in the Lake Division, 5-4. So Coach Hyman in 3 years has a plus 500 record at 15-14 and 11-5 in PAL divisional play. He's done very well.
Hyman, knows power football. He loves to get a kid who will run the rock. They seem to really do a fantastic job developing their offensive line. They've always been a physical and power football style team, and that's what they're showing on offense, and they're traditional in terms of their defensive sets as well. They run, you know, essentially a four-man line with four linebackers and usually some kind of zone coverage behind it, and they just trust their kids to play hard and trust in the scheme. It looks like Alfaro is up and coming off the field on his own power, but Capuchino's got it going. This group of kids they have has a special bond, and they're playing like it today.
Coach Heineman's Battle of the Strip record is 1-1. In 2006, he lost here at Mills 42-20, and then, of course, last year won at Capuchino 21-6. He's a PE teacher at Capuchino, local San Bruno resident, former Capuchino student. Here's Ewing bouncing it from the outside out to the right, and he is brought down near the first down marker, making that tackle for the Vikings was the Andrew Singh linebacker, and he is a little bit upset after that ball ricocheted off him on the special teams.
Right, you can see him bring down Ewing on the play there. 1:20 to go on the clock. Maybe a little increased sense of urgency for Capuchino to try to get in the end zone before half.
Coach Heineman played offensive line and linebacker for the Mustangs back in the day. Here's Ewing, breaks through once again and drags a couple defenders. Now that's pretty difficult. You got two guys hanging on your legs, and yet he was still able to jump in the air.
He is tough. You can see just by the way he's built, he's got a lot of power in his lower body, and that he is used to. Here he is on the replay, taking on the low tackler, and finally is knocked to the ground. But you're right, he's dragging guys along with him for the ride. Exciting runner and some relentless defense by Mills as well.
First and 10 from the 29. Is that Ewing again? Starts to the right, heads to the left, going for the pylon, and he's going to be just short as he looks to be inside the five. It's tough to tell from here. And the whistle blows to stop the clock. Ewing a little bit slow getting up, but now he's doing just fine, trotting back.
Yeah, he on that play, he started off to the right and saw that it was bottled up, and the Vikings did a great job of what we call gap responsibility, staying in their area, and so Ewing cut it back. Some of those backside guys weren't home, and so he found a crease, took it upfield, and almost scored on the play. Tremendous vision by Ewing.
Here's a look at the replay, Steve.
Okay, here we go. You see it here where he's bottled up, cuts back, and there's some overflow. And next thing you know, he's running it on the field by himself. He finally gets caught by two guys at the end, almost scores on the play.
Coach Heineman said about Ewing before the game and earlier this week, quote, he did tons of work in the offseason. Coach Heineman went on to say, quote, he's bigger, faster, stronger, and has built his endurance. Plus, he doesn't play defense. That helps.
It helps when you're over there able to get your rest and get your air back. And so they can count on him to go 100% on every snap offensively. And he's shown that he can be relied upon here today and throughout the season.
First and goal from the three. I formation. Give it to Ewing over the right side. He's going to talk and walk right into the end zone. Touchdown, Ewing. Touchdown, Mustangs.
He looked like he was going to run that tight off tackle or maybe even in the guard tackle gap. But then he looked outside and saw a huge amount. Here's the replay. Starts on the inside. Oh, I think I'll just take it out here where there's nobody and get my team 6 points. Waltzing into the end zone was Ewing on that play. Outstanding run.
Ewing's third touchdown run of the afternoon. A flag comes out before the snap. 26-13.
Substitution on the offense.
Substitution infraction goes against the Mustangs, called by referee John Petrovich, a veteran official. And so that'll back them up five more. Arturo Picazzo missed his first, made his last two, going for three in a row. A little bit further back, and it's off to the left. It's no good.
Wow.
So the score will remain 26-13. They actually changed it to 27-13 on the scoreboard, and now they've got it back with 37 seconds left to go until intermission.
Well, when the clock was at 5:36, the Capuchino Mustangs took a ball and marched it downfield and scored with about 2 minutes and 20 seconds on the clock. And then they kicked the ball off and had that kind of unusual squib kick off of number 51, got the ball, marched down, scored again. They scored two touchdowns in about 4 minutes and 30 seconds to take the lead 26-13 here.
That's that quick strike offense of the Mustangs led by Ewing. And a quick update of Justin. He has now carried the ball 26 times for 145 yards. His magic number is now down to 152. And the kickoff is fumbled once again and finally picked up by Jeffrey inside his five. Jeffrey's got a hole. Sometimes on a broken play, you can bust it. Jeffrey trying to do so. Picks up a great block. Jeffrey down to the 40. Jeffrey inside the 30, down to the 25, and he's brought down. And a lot of times, Steve, on those special teams, broken plays, a fumble, and everybody kind of gets out of whack, and then all of a sudden, you break open a big one.
That's right, and that's in that case, Jeffrey stayed with it on that play and found a fantastic crease down the middle, and Cap defenders had indeed overrun the play, and Jeffrey says, all right, let me get some of that quick strike opportunity. I'll take this thing to the house myself. They caught him just barely by his heels and brought him down, but he puts Cap in, Mills in good position.
Lal back to throw from the shotgun, fires it over to the left side, slightly overthrown, falls incomplete, intended for Jeffrey, and maybe we can catch that replay once again. He picked up a great block there. I think it was around the 40-yard line. I'm not sure if our crew can dial that back up or not.
Well, it's those squib kicks generally, because here it is, where he picks up the bounce, it's a squib kick, and then he retreats, and he finds some a lane there and some vision on it and wiggles through, and before you know it, he's almost gone. Great job by the crew picking up the replay, and you see him being tackled after the super long run back.
Very well done by our MCTV Sports crew, led by Randy Sahai and Andy Pittman.
In this situation, Kenny, I wouldn't be surprised to see some kind of screen. They need to get the ball downfield. They've got 20 seconds on the clock, and oftentimes you say you want to go, you know, to the end zone. At the same time, if I'm playing defense or running the defense for Capuchino, I'm defending that, and I'm making sure that nothing gets behind me, because they are with a goal-to-go situation essentially in 20 seconds. But I think screen, that just would be my thought, where you have a chance to throw it behind the line of scrimmage, pick up some blockers, and get escorted into the end zone. It'll be interesting to see what they come up with.
We have a delay on the field. It looks like one of the referees is trying to fix the yard marker. So while we have a break, we have an opportunity to mention how important this game is for Capuchino in trying to win the Lake Division outright. They are going to make the CCS no matter what. They could be projected as a number 7 seed. In fact, in Division 3, they appear tied with Soledad, and it's going to be a coin flip between Soledad and Capuchino on who gets the 7 seed. The winner of the coin flip will get the 7 and play Valley Christian. Whoever loses the flip will get the 8 seed and have to play Monterey. Here's a pass by Lal, head of the corner of the end zone. It passes caught, and it's a touchdown. A beautiful throw and a great catch by Beglitzoff. 25 yards, and Mills answers that Cap score, and they answered it quickly, Steve.
Quick strike capability by both these teams on display today, and this is a true rivalry tradition football game. Neither of these teams giving up. Both teams throwing body blows and punches, and this play was a beautiful fade ball thrown to the corner there. The Capuchino defender kind of lost track, evidently, of the ball. But the receiver, Victor Beglitzoff, was fantastic on that play for the touchdown.
And Beglitzoff will kick the extra point off the hold of Sved, and the kick is good. So let's check the scoreboard, 26-20. We've had 46 points scored here in the first half, Steve. 14 seconds left till intermission. It wasn't expected to be that high scoring.
Well, you know what? I bet these folks sitting in the stands feel like they paid more for less. I mean, doggone it. This thing is entertaining, and it's fun when it's your own kids and it's your own people, and there's such a tradition. I saw before the game, these kids all know each other. There's obviously a game to be played, and so you want to be sure to carry out your responsibility. But these kids have grown up together. Many of them are friends, and it's great to see them, both teams, playing so hard and playing so well here today.
And we asked Coach Heineman about this big rivalry, and he responded with a quote of how special it is to him and all his players. And we also asked Coach Krieger about taking on this Capuchino squad, and he said, quote, "Cap presents a great challenge for us. Their running back Ewing has a tremendous year and is trying to break a CCS rushing record, and our defense will need to be at their best to contain him. Cap's defense is aggressive and brings pressure every play," end quote. And on that play, the kind of pressure kind of ended up biting them, and they had single coverage out there, and Law was able to find Beglitzoff for the touchdown.
I tell you that Coach Krieger really had a lot of great things to say about Law, and that he is an accurate passer, and he's one of their leaders on offense, and that's on display today. Great throw and catch.
And the kick is taken by one of the upbacks at the 20-yard line for Capuchino, and getting brought down and knocked down was Chris Costa up near the 34. It's going to be a return of about 14. Capuchino, with just 8 seconds left, will likely sit on it, or will they try another Ewing handoff?
I think you take a shot at whatever you have. I don't know if it's anything tricky. Maybe it is just Ewing. But I think you make a positive offensive play somehow and see what you can do.
Let's see what they do. They got two receivers out to the left. Doubtway is going to throw. No, he's going to tuck it and run. He's headed to the right sideline. He's still on his feet up near the 50 and then stumbles there, and that's going to run out the clock. So we have reached intermission. A quite entertaining first half as the Vikings in scarlet and gold have put up quite a challenge to the PAL Lake Division champion Mustangs, and the scoreboard reads 26-20, Capuchino on top.
An outstanding game we've seen so far. I mean, both teams on offense have really executed their game plans. They've each moved the ball with some degree of success. It's going to come down to which of these defenses can make a couple stops in the second half and give their team a chance to come out ahead ultimately at the final buzzer.
You know, earlier in the week we put together this highlights package, and we'd like to show it if possible. Mills will certainly have their work cut out, and to win they must contain Ewing. We've talked about that, and get their own offense in gear. This was some kind of trouble for Mills last year, and we'll take a look back at the 46th Battle of the Strip held a year ago, November 10th, under the lights at Capuchino. The captains from Mills and Cap met at midfield in the first quarter. Cap quarterback Vince Garcia rolled out and passed the tight end Luciano Molina for a first down, setting up a one-yard run by Justin Ewing. The Mustangs were up 7-0. Second quarter, after a 55-yard run by Ewing, he finishes the drive with the carry from 5 yards out. Capuchino 14, Mills nothing. Still in the second quarter, the Vikings finally get on the board. Garcia fumbles the ball, and Brian Liang recovers it, running 76 yards down the sideline for the score. Extra point, no good. Cap up 14-6. But that is all the Vikings will get as Cap seals it. Jordan Griffiths runs in for 2 yards out, giving the Mustangs the 21-6 victory. So the game is, of course, the main feature today, but the Battle of the Strip is more than just a game. As is the annual tradition, prior to the teams taking the field, there's a parade around the stadium so fans can get these guys pumped up for a great game. Our MCTV cameras were there to capture the festivities, and here's a look.